الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، all praises due to Allah abundantly. We praise Him and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In pursuit of happiness, ouch. Yep. There you go. Well, can we begin again? I'll start again. That's why please turn off your phone. It really means turn off the phone. Inshallah. It happens to the best of us. Ma'afi mushkila, but alhamdulillah. And I request the sisters also to lend me their silence. I'm a very strange person. I get easily distracted. So you have to bear with me since I'm the speaker. In the future, inshallah, we'll find another speaker who is not as sensitive as myself. But until then, be patient. Here we go again. Alhamdulillah, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fih. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'an bi ihsanin ila yawm al-deen. Amma ba'd. All praise is due to Allah. And we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In pursuit of happiness, people go through all kinds of hardships and strive to overcome any kind of difficulty. And furthermore, they believe that whatever they do, even if it's wrong, is justified. Because happiness is the goal of every creature. Attaining happiness, the pursuit of happiness is the goal of every creature. Not only human beings, even animals want to be happy. And they work very hard, like the bees and ants and others. And all the things they do is really, in a sense, trying to be in the state of contentment. So they will not suffer because of some other, you know, weather effect that may happen. By Allah's decree, of course, you find that animals, you know, and ants, and they make certain preparations to protect themselves from any potential harm or danger. And so do the rest of the animals in the animal kingdom. Human beings, obviously, are more stern and keen on attaining this happiness. I don't think anyone here or anyone who will watch this in the future is an exception to the rule. Everyone wants to be happy. In modern days, people, perhaps we can say that students are an exception. Students are an exception. But if you're not a student, then you spend most of your time in two places. Where are they? Or what are they? If you're not a student in school, because that's usually where you spend most of your time. If you're married, where are the two places where you spend most of your time?
Home and office.
Home and office. Well, office is specific. Work. Right? You may work outside an office. Work and home. This is where most of the time is spent. And if one is able to ensure that these two locations are a source of happiness and, you know, genuine happiness, not something else, as you will see later on, then you can almost guarantee happiness in the rest of your affairs. Because the time where you spend the most in these two locations, you have a peace of mind. You're satisfied. Without that, attaining happiness becomes almost impossible. As in everything, Islam did not leave this aspect of our lives unattended. There's nothing in this life except that Islam shed some light on how to deal with it and what are the steps that we need to take in order to acquire this happiness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed this issue in the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed this issue in his sunnah. They gave us practical steps we can take so that we can acquire this happiness. So that home becomes a place of peace, not a war zone. Because for many, home is a war zone. The only thing missing is the M16s and the Kalashnikovs and the grenades and all the other weapons. If we had these weapons, no one would be alive. The home would already be, you know, in the past. But because of lack of weaponry, people are alive, but it's a war zone. Husband with wife, father with son, daughter with mother, daughter with father, and you know, everybody's going in opposite directions, which is not very good. In the short span of time that I've personally spent in da'wah, and because of this creation of the email address onewaytoparadise@gmail.com, I got to look into the personal affairs of many of the Muslims all over the world. And it's nothing to be happy about. It is nothing to be happy about. The emails I receive, the stories that I hear, is sometimes simply like something close to imagination. You think it's a fairy tale. You won't think such things really happen in Muslim homes among Muslims. But this is not the case. These are real stories. Real, genuine problems that you cannot even begin to advise on how to deal with. Because the foundation was no good. And when the foundation is no good, you can try to fix up the rest of the things which you have attached or you have built on this foundation, but it's bound to be demolished because the foundation is not sound. So Allah musta'an. This is where we got the title domestic confrontations. Domestic has a number of meanings. The meaning intended in this title is within the household, within one household. Confrontations is the conflict between two forces. That's also one of the meanings or the one intended here. So the conflict between two forces, two contending forces, two opposing forces within a single household brings about domestic confrontations. And you may have heard the term domestic violence, which is the phenomena of a husband beating his wife. Or you'll be shocked to hear a wife beating her husband, especially if she was a wrestler before they got married and he's a skinny guy. It usually doesn't end up very good for him, but these things do happen. Now the reason behind that, you may wonder, why are Muslims doing such a horrible job? Not all Muslims, excuse me. So many Muslims are doing a bad job in this regard. And the answer is the lack of understanding of the divine teachings. We don't really understand what Allah had taught and what the Prophet ﷺ had taught. We don't really know. We have general, ambiguous, you know, vague ideas, but we don't have any details, specifically in the area of divorce, where most Muslims don't know the rulings concerning divorce. So you get questions that are very odd and Islamically are rejected. But people divorce each other in all kinds of ways. The most recent email which I received was that the brother had such a big problem with his wife who burnt the house down, and she stole the furniture, and she went to his mother's house, or afwan, her mother's house, and then the brother saying, but she hasn't divorced him yet. Who's gonna divorce who? The brother thinks the woman is the one who has divorce in her hand. After all these things she did to him, he doesn't know that he's the one who's supposed to say, hey, anti talik, you're divorced. He's waiting for her to divorce him. She's taking the money, taking the furniture, living at her mother's house, everything's good. Mr. Genius is waiting for the divorce from wifey. And I'm reading these emails like, are you serious, man? Come on, brother. This is basic information. If you want divorce, you better ask for it. If she wants khula, that's a whole other discussion. You have to initiate divorce. And we will see the rulings concerning that. And no, we're not equal. No, Islam does not teach equality between men and women. Whoever told you that is a liar. There's no equality, we're not equal. Islam teaches justice between men and women. And justice means a man has a role to play And women has a role to play. And we cannot turn them around and delegate different tasks to different genders. It doesn't work. And the biggest evidence is the Western failure in this aspect. When they try to turn it, you know, the tables around and people playing different roles, you don't know what's happening anymore. No one is running the house. Children are unattended. They don't raise them correctly. And you hear all kinds of strange stories, murder, rape, molestation, all kinds of odd things which you usually don't hear in the Muslim family because of that switch. So, you know, when we speak, brothers, know that you have some rights which Allah gave you that you cannot violate and transgress against. And sisters, the same goes to you. There are some aspects which you have to fulfill and some rights which you have, and Islam guarantees you both. You cannot ask for the rights and then also want to go beyond the limits which Allah gave you. If you do so, then you will be among the main reasons behind the destruction of the household, as it goes for the brother. So we don't want to undermine, we don't want to undermine each other's rights and duties and roles which we play, so that the household will be that of prosperity, of iman, and means for the household, the whole family, to enter Jannah and not to go to Jahannam, wal-iyadu billah. طيب. So this lecture aims at actually providing us with the foundation on which we can build the sound Islamic household by speaking and explaining the role that each one of us should play at home. If you're not married, then I guess inshallah that would be your first step towards marriage and a preparation. It's like a course. You can say, I took a course on marriage before marriage. So maybe inshallah you'll become a better husband, and if a sister, you become a better wife. And obviously we're going to do this according to the Quran and the Sunnah, along with the understanding of the righteous predecessors. Not anything else, not anyone else, not Mr. you know, Fulan philosopher, or Mr. you know, I don't know what, doctor. We don't care about these individuals if they're going to give us views which conflict with the Quran and the Sunnah. And we have plenty if we only understood. Wallahu musta'an. Reflect, think about what you will be hearing in the next few minutes. Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. Allah has made for you from your homes a place of rest. Allah is telling us that your home is a place of rest. Today, how many of us can say our home is a place of rest? Whether you are a child dealing with parents that don't get along, or whether you are a father dealing with children who don't listen, or whether you're a wife dealing with a husband who's disobedient to Allah, or your husband dealing with a wife who's disobedient to you and to Allah, how many of us can say home is a place of rest? Perhaps many will say home is a place of unrest and distress and stress, but not rest. إلا من رحم الله. But Allah saying, He made our homes a place for rest. If we're not resting, we're not fulfilling the objective behind the house Azza wa Jal had initiated for us as a place for rest. وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. This is the first ayah. Reflect on the second ayah. أَفَمَنْ أَسَّسَ بُنْيَانَهُ عَلَى تَقْوَى مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانِ خَيْرٌ أَمَّنْ أَسَّسَ بُنْيَانَهُ عَلَى شَفَى جُرُفٍ هَارٍ فَانْهَارَ بِهِ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ. Listen to this. Then is one who laid the foundation of his building on righteousness and seeking the pleasure of Allah, righteousness and seeking the pleasure of Allah, better, or one who laid the foundation of his building on the edge of a bank, you know, that land near the river or the lake, at the edge of a bank, about to collapse. It's unstable. It's not firm. He's standing at an area where it's just about to fall. Then what happens? So it collapsed with him into the fire of hell. Who is better? The one who builds his foundation. The one who builds his bunyan upon his foundation of taqwa and seeking Allah's pleasure. Is he the same as the one who builds it on a bank an edge which is about to collapse, and indeed, once you have so many people standing on it, and let's think about it in this sense, figuratively speaking, if it's a bank at the edge of a river or a lake, and you're standing by yourself, then you bring your family members with you, aren't you heavier? When all of these individuals lack righteousness and seeking Allah's pleasure, it's about to collapse. But where will it collapse? If it collapses in the river so you can have a nice swim, that would be lovely. But it will collapse in the hellfire. And that's not lovely. That's very bad. A whole family going to Jahannam together versus a whole family going to Jannah together. That's what it boils down to. How do we determine that today? What is this house built? What is it founded on? Is it founded on nonsense? Is it founded on disobedience? Is it founded on haram? The earning is haram. The TV is on 24/7. All kinds of music and naked women and what have you. Right? The father comes in and out like a hotel. It's like a hotel. He comes to sleep at night. Then they don't see him. No time for the family. What is going on? And it's not like he's given dawah outside. He's at the coffee shop down the street with the shisha, the argila, the big old, bomb that the people smoke, as if one cigarette is not enough. Let's see how much more damage we can cause to our lungs and the Muslims around us. So they got a big old one now with pounds of smoke coming out. That's what the husband is doing. Wife, the wife is all day on the phone, girgir, as they say, gossiping and backbiting and speaking about all the neighbors and these people did this and whatever, the school is bad, and they go through the list of teachers in the school, everyone gets a piece of the pie as well, right? And then, all day watching soap operas, this is the most important episode, children are dying, they're hungry, they need attention, but the soap opera, man, we can't leave that alone now. And Danube, I just remember, we need shopping. So she, puts on half of her clothes, not all of her clothes, half of them to go to Danube and buy some, kind swaps. It's an important shopping, adventure now. Please, don't stop me. So she's a fitna from the time she leaves home until she makes it to Danube, Raya, whatever you shop. I always say Danube because I live across the street from Danube. For those who are living in other countries, it's a supermarket. Okay? They go to the supermarket, cause fitna to hundreds of men. And hubby pie is at home, flipping through the channels. Let the wife go buy the groceries. Yeah, that's not the Islamic household, man. This is something else. This is something very, very strange. It's an alien concept in Islam. And we've delivered many lectures already on these topics. The clothing for one another. The where is this wedding heading? The rights of the children. The rights of the parents. Is this is to go into Jannah? All of these lectures address what each one of us has to do in this life to go to Jannah. Now, when we spoke, about this foundation, this sound, profound foundation, before we go into the reasons why the household is broken apart, we should first see where the mistakes happened. You see, it begins with choosing the spouse. This idea of building your foundation on a bank, which is about to collapse in the hellfire, usually begins with the choice of a spouse. Who does the sister marry as a man, and who does the brother marry as a wife? Now, amazingly, we have two narrations from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one speaking to the men and one speaking to the women, and you will find in both narrations there's a common denominator between them. There's one thing which we should pay attention to. Listen to this. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, tunkahul mar'a li arba' limaliha li hasabiha li jamaliha وَلِدِينِهَا فَاظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَكَ. A woman is married for four main reasons. Four main reasons. Her wealth, she's got fulus. And every lazy man on earth loves a woman with fulus. So he can say, honey, I couldn't find a job. And mashallah, you're so rich. You can take care of us, inshallah. You pay the rent. We buy this car. I love you, right? This is when the love comes. Love you very much. So he lives off his wife. Very unfortunate. Scheming. Not Islamic. But whatever. These men exist, FYI. For your information. They exist. For her wealth. For her beauty. She's a beautiful woman. طيب. But it doesn't end there. And they say, according to the experts, no matter how beautiful she is, after a few months, خلاص. That sensation is over. Then you have to deal with the rest. The beauty factor is done. It's the norm. What came with that beauty is an issue. Not undermining beauty. If the sister's a born again and beautiful, alhamdulillah. But that's not the main thing to look for. Thirdly, لحسبها, her lineage. Today we call it wasta. You know? So someone, you know, who's from some country, he tries to marry a Western woman so he can get the citizenship. Brother, you know, she's American? Oh, okay, yeah. I think I like American Muslims. Why? Well, because he can imagine a blue passport, you know, with which he can travel all over the world and become an American so he can get a special treatment, extra salary. You know how it goes. That's one reason why people marry. Wasta. Or she's connected to some people in charge, you know, part of the royal family or something along these lines. Anything that will get you by, yani, huh? لحسبها. Then the last one, which is the most fundamental, لدينها. Because of a religious commitment, and regarding that last one, the Prophet ﷺ made his comment, so then take that one, take hold of the one with the religious commitment, may your hands be rubbed with dust. This is the advice of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who doesn't speak of his own desire. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. He doesn't speak of his own desire. This is from the revelation of Allah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Marry the woman of religious commitment. She will give you a peace of mind. If she has a nice lineage and she doesn't have a religious commitment, you will suffer eventually. And the same lineage may be the reason why you'll be kicked out of a country. Because when you go off track, then she will go back to the same wasta, say, hey, I don't like this guy. And then you, next thing you know, you're out. Or you're in prison. And if she's beautiful, this may be a fitna, if she doesn't fear Allah. And you know what I'm saying. And if she's wealthy, and she doesn't have a religious commitment, she may say, hey, that's my money. I want to spend it however I like. Bring on the biggest TV screen in the market. And you can't say no, because she's spending money on you. So you'll be in trouble if she doesn't fear Allah. Fearing Allah, being religiously committed, is a fundamental principle. If you don't find a woman with this characteristic, you might as well not marry. Because anything else may destroy you. That's for the brothers. Sisters, the Messenger of Allah said to you, or to your family, since you don't give yourself in marriage, as the other email which I received, as a woman was going out in haram with a man, so a religiously committed person supposedly told them, you guys, you know, this is haram, and you cannot be like this. So either you separate or you get married. They said, sure, we'll get married, who cares? But my father will never accept him. Said, well, your father has nothing to do with it. My friend, he will be your wali, and these couple of guys will be the witnesses. Khalas. So the lady married this man, you know, with a guardian, a wali, whom she doesn't know. Her father's alive, and he's there, who's supposed to be the wali. They ignored him, put him on ignore. And next thing you know, Allah guides her. And now the question comes, was this marriage even valid? The idea which is available in one of the madhahib, without mentioning this madhab, that a woman may give herself off in marriage is batil. This is false, and it negates the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet ﷺ spoke to the awliya, those responsible of a woman. إِذَا أَتَاكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوا. تكن فتنة في الأرض وفساد عريض. If one comes to you whom you are pleased with his deen, his religious commitment, وخلقه, his character, then give him that woman in marriage. So we do, let him marry. If you don't, it will be fitna. There will be major fitna upon earth, وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيدٌ, and wide corruption. That's what happens. He's not a doctor, he's not an engineer, he didn't graduate from I don't know where, he doesn't make that much money, and blah, 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 all these standards. While the brother is religiously committed, so he's rejected on these grounds, according to Prophet ﷺ, if you don't give him in marriage, there will be fitna. And this fitna may begin with your household. And this fasad arid may begin in that household. So the woman is prevented from marrying a religiously committed man by her parents, who keep, you know, depriving her of her rights until what they don't want to happen happens. Human beings are human beings, they have needs. That's why Allah gave us the outlet of marriage. So the parents have to be reasonable as well. If you got some fulus, and the man doesn't have some fulus, help him out. Hire him in your business. Get him to work with you. Help out if he fears Allah regarding your daughter. Rather than bringing a clown into the family who's got a lot of money, but he doesn't fear Allah, he's not of good character, and he doesn't behave well, he will embarrass you, he will oppress your daughter, he will put her through hell, as they say, in this life. Through torture. She will be tortured. We need to prioritize. Specifically for the parents. Because today it became business. It became a business. So much so that we picked up some of the Hindu rituals or whatever, that now a woman buys a man. They call it mahar. They go, you know, usually the man gives the mahar to the woman. In some cultures, it's the woman who gives the mahar to the man. That's not mahar, that's called purchase. And I've heard, if he's a doctor, oh man, that's not the same like the regular guy. You gotta pay a lot more money to buy him. A woman now has to buy a man. That's ajeeb, ajeeb. Where do we get these traditions from? Only Allah knows. Oh, we know as well from who? From all the kuffar in the world. So all this we need to, you know, leave alone. This cultural stuff, if it's going to conflict with the deen of Allah, we need to throw it in the trash. Specifically when it comes from the enemies of Allah and the most feeble-minded creatures, the kuffar, whom Allah said, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُ. They're like the cattle, they're more astray. They don't know anything. We're going to learn from them. A woman pays a dowry to a man to marry her, reversing the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. Parents then have a huge responsibility concerning who they give their daughters in marriage, excuse me, to. طيب. So now that we begin with this foundation, then you can eliminate the future potential problems. If you don't begin with this foundation, then this is where you will suffer. And the fact that this happens does not mean that we don't find treatment. Because what happens sometimes is that someone wasn't practicing, and they got married while both were not practicing. Then Allah guides one of the two spouses. Then they have to suffer with the other spouse who's still not practicing. Or sometimes both of them are guided, or sometimes none of them is guided. Either way, because of the possibility of someone making the wrong choice, then wanting to change, what I will mention right now are the things which we can do in order to keep the house a place of rest and harmonious. And I'll begin with the advice to the men. Then we will give advice to the women. Then we will give advice to both genders. Brothers in Islam, fear Allah at home. Fear Allah Azza wa Jal at home. Allah is the object of worship and the one who we enslave ourselves to in the masjid, at home, at work, in the street, and wherever we may be. There's no such thing as at the masjid you're Shaykh al-Islam, and at home you are Shaykh al-Shayateen. You can't do that. Yes, we will have problems and shortcomings. I'm not saying anyone will reach perfection. No, 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 no. Don't misunderstand me. But there's a level of acceptability. There's a standard average which you cannot go below. And when a brother doesn't fear Allah, and the woman is trying to please Allah, it becomes very difficult for the sisters. And the worst problem that I've received in the emails is husbands who don't pray. The man who abandons the salah. And this is a very technical discussion. Keeping in mind that there's a difference of opinion among the scholars, and that the opinion which is super strong is that the man who doesn't pray or the woman who doesn't pray, they're not Muslims anymore. They're not Muslims anymore. They have left Islam. They have left Islam. So now, a Muslim woman can never be under the care and the authority of an apostate or a kafir. Never. So if the man doesn't pray, then this is grounds for him to lose his wife, which invalidates the marriage and puts an end to everything, every right which he has concerning children and otherwise, because he does not have any rights as an apostate. In fact, if he was in a Muslim state, they'd be chopping off his neck. So I say to those men whom Allah has blessed with righteous wives, fear Allah and establish the salah. This is the minimum which you cannot forsake ever in your life. Never, please stop playing with the elastic. Never ever abandon the salah no matter what. This is the minimum. If you don't, you have no right over this woman. No right over this woman. Secondly, the computer, laptop, iPhones, or anything which may be private or can be used privately. This is, again, something which we need to be super careful about. Facebook, and I'm not going to go back to Facebook. Alhamdulillah, I closed my account, FYI. After a lot of struggle, no more Facebook. Only one way to pray that. My personal account is gone with the wind. And I have much more time now, alhamdulillah. Shh. But that's besides the point. Be careful of anything which the shaitan may use to lead you astray. We are weak. وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Allah said it clearly in the Quran. And a human was created weak. We are weak. Everyone has desires. Everyone has inclinations to evil. Everyone has tendencies. If we do not control them, we may go astray. So fearing Allah concerning in your household will at least provide you with a wife, or will provide you with the ability to have a wife who also responds in the same fashion, who also fears Allah. If we don't fear Allah in the house, then we want our wives to obey us. We have lost the equation. Because if we don't fix our relationship with Allah, it's very difficult to fix the relationship with the creation. So first one must return to Allah. Salah, avoiding prohibitions, avoiding earning haram. Don't work for a bank, and don't deal with banks, and don't deal with anything dealing with riba, anything dealing with images, anything dealing with music. If you are in IT and you develop softwares where people put music on them and you are involved, all these are haram. You say, brother, but this, come on, man, life. Say, listen, man, Allah gave us millions of things to do and 20 things that are haram. If you're going to insist that the only things you can work on are these 20 things, then you have, it's a very strange choice. You cannot convince me that there's no halal job out there. And it doesn't have to be office work. If the only office work you're able to get is that of haram, then don't work in an office, ya akhi. Start your own business. Sell shoes. What's the big deal? You know who makes the most money? Restaurants. Brothers invited me for lunch the other day. A kilo of kebab, 80 riyals. I'm looking at the owner of the restaurant, I'm saying, man, mashallah, they got how many customers here? Man, this guy must go home with 50,000 riyals every time he opens up between Dhuhr and Asr. That's money right there. Fool and tamiz. You think it doesn't make money? It makes money. Don't get stuck on offices. Wallah, brother, insurance and this. No, Habibi. If office work, the only office work you know how to do involves haram, don't work in an office. Do anything that is halal that will bless your household. Haram money will destroy the household. Allah will not accept your dua. The money will go to waste. And we all know the consequences of that. And anyway, special lectures will be dedicated to that topic, inshallah ta'ala, in the future. Fearing Allah. Secondly, fulfill the basic rights of your family. Allah said, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّمُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَبِمَا أَنْفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Men are in charge of women. And this is what I was referring to earlier, sisters. Don't get upset. If you get upset, then you don't like what Allah revealed. And you know that this is something that we don't play with. That's what Allah said. Men are in charge, and another nicer translation is are caretakers of women. Why? By right of what Allah has given one over the other and what they spend from their wealth. Allah gave a specific right to the man and he made it obligatory on him to spend on his wife and his family. Because of that right of spending, he gets particular privileges of being the caretaker. You say, but you know, this is not fair. Say, okay, then how come you're working in a business where the owner is the one who says how things should happen at work? Why don't the employees who get paid tell him, tell the boss how to run business? Why do you have to listen to the boss? He owns it. He's the one who's paying you the salary. If you don't like it, start your own business. So this concept is something we accept in the business world. I don't know why we reject it in our household. Allah gave him this right. We men, though, however, should not take advantage of this right. Because some people think that that means that you're a dictator. And that you come into the home with a machine gun. And you sit on this big sofa and you put your feet up and then you expect it to take off your shoes and take off your socks and massage your feet. And then where's the food? You know, you watch some movies and some people want to leave the movie at home. Where's the food? What is this? What is that? All day screaming, you know? And then it may get, you know, to physical violence. Someone beating his wife, which is something that is really not entertained. The concept of striking one's wife has very, you know, limited guidelines in Islam. Not as many people think. That's a boxing match at home. And we will deal with that in a little bit, inshallah. Anyways, so you, brother, have to take care of your wife. You have to work. You have to earn a living. You have to spend on her. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, O Allah's Messenger, what is the right of one's wife upon him? He said that you feed her when you feed yourself. You don't have bake and she eats the leftover from yesterday. Huh? You don't eat something and she eats something else. You feed her from what you eat. And you clothe her when you clothe yourself. Unless, mashallah, she's very righteous, says it's okay, I don't need any more dresses. Then you can buy yourself a thobe and you don't have to buy her a dress. But if she wants one, then you give her one. That you should not strike her in the face. Don't be striking the face and never invoke ugliness upon her by saying, you know, you're ugly or قَبَّحَكِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. It's a dua where basically you're degrading her, so speaking to her in a manner that is not befitting. And do not separate from them except in their homes. And there's a difference of opinion among the scholars because we have other evidences Prophet ﷺ left the house. But the asal is that you don't, if there's, for whatever reason, they're separate, not separation, they're disagreeing on something, the man doesn't go stay in a hotel. The asal is that he remains at home, but they avoid something else, if you know what I mean. The second responsibility of the man is that you spend time with your family. Some of the Sahaba were super worshippers, mashallah. One of them, his father gave his son, he gave him in marriage to a woman from Quraysh, a noble woman from Quraysh. And he spent the night in siyam, in qiyam. His first night, he spent it doing salah. And the next day he was fasting. So the father knew his son had the tendency to, you know, be, mashallah, yani, inclined towards ibadah. So he went to the wife and said, you know, how's everything? He said, wallah, he's an excellent man, but we didn't see him last night. So then he went and he spoke to his son. And anyways, the information was conveyed to the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, observe fast sometimes and leave them at others. Stand for the night prayer and also sleep at night. Your body has a right over you, your eyes have a right over you, and your wife has a right over you. And the hadith is in Bukhari. So, nowadays, you would wish that one of us is spending the night in Qiyam. Huh? Now that the same root, the same thing, the same consequence, the wife not getting her right, but it's, you know, spending it with the buddies, or with the best friend, the TV, or the other best friend, the pocket PC. Someone's second wife, usually. The most common second wife at home now is a pocket PC for most men. Illa ma rahim Allah. Nowadays, it's not like we're spending the night in ibadah. No. We don't give the woman her right, but unfortunately, it's being done with things that are not even lawful or pleasing to Allah Azza wa Jal. We have gone way too far from the way of the Sahaba. We ask Allah to pardon us. Thirdly, know her feelings. Know her feelings. The Prophet ﷺ said to Aisha, I know when you are happy, when you are pleased with me, and when you are displeased with me. She said, how do you know? He said, when you are pleased with me, you say, Wa Rabbi Muhammad, you swear by the Lord of Muhammad. And when you displease with me, you swear by Rabb of Ibrahim. He notices the choice of words. She said, yes, I only emit the name of Messenger of Allah. I only don't say your name. So know the feeling. Women are very fragile creatures. And we have to be sensitive enough, even though we usually lack sensitivity, we're insensitive, but we have to develop a sense of sensitivity to this woman. You know when you buy some boxes that have glasses, and it says, you know, fragile, handle with care, breakable, and all these things? That's a woman, in essence. So if we don't pay attention to the feelings, we will suffer. You will be the first one to pay the consequences. So be a little sensitive, be gentle, try to, you know, see how she feels. Is she upset? Is she happy? And make sure that everything at home is harmonious. Understand their jealousy. If you have a second wife, then women are quite jealous. Even the sahabiyat, bal ummahat al-mu'mineen. The wives of the Prophet ﷺ, the mothers of the believers. Ummu Salama once brought some food in a plate to the Prophet ﷺ while he was at Aisha's house and he had some guests. What did Aisha do? She knocked the plate over. She knocked the plate over, it fell and it broke. Now the Prophet ﷺ, one of us would do, one of us, that would be it. Khalas. You're divorced and you're divorced, even if the other one didn't do anything. Everybody, talaq, talaq, talaq. Yalla, talaq is like, you know, breathing air now. All day, talaq, talaq. He doesn't even know what talaq means, but nothing mushkila. He would have divorced two and a third one. Even if he doesn't have a third, he said, if I marry a third wife, she's talaq also. And he may punch his wife and, you know, scold her in front of people. Prophet ﷺ said, gharat ummukum. He picked up the plate. He said, your mother has become jealous. Your mother Aisha has become jealous. He took a plate from Aisha's and he gave it to Ummu Salama that this is for that. You broke her plate, then you get a plate. He reimbursed her for the plate. Khalas. Which one of us can do this today? And sometimes jealousy is not only with the second wife, she could be jealous of your mother. You know about that. Especially if she doesn't cook as good as your mother. Right? So you need to be very careful. Always say the food is good. Even if the sisters can hear me now, still. Always say the food is good. Even if it's not good. By then you can deal with it in your own privacy. But in front of everyone else, khali wali, as they say. Otherwise, she will be jealous of your mother. And she may say, I'm not going to cook anymore. They throw fits. I'm not going to cook. You don't like my food? Okay, no problem. You buy us food every day. Then you have to say, please, Allah, you know, please, we need that. And then you have to go through a lot of sufferings and bring family members and go to the judge just so your wife can cook again. You know what I'm saying, man. Maybe some of you are laughing. It's like, how did you know what happens in my house? I don't know. I'm just guessing. I told you I get a lot of emails. Allah understand. Understanding their psychology and nature. And sisters, again, understand the truth concerning the difference between men and women. Now, the Prophet ﷺ is saying this. He said, I command you to take care of the woman in a good manner, for they are created from a rib. And the most crooked portion of the rib is its upper part. If you try to straighten it, it will break. And if you leave it, it will remain crooked. So I command you to take care of women in the best manner. This is the bottom line. And any woman who rejects this hadith is a proof about what it's saying. You see what I'm saying? If she doesn't like the hadith, this is the proof. Exactly what he said. It's crooked. Doesn't want to believe. This is the truth. Why? We say we have our own set of problems as men. We have our own set of problems. We have our own issues. This is an issue. Let's just imagine now, this is a rib, even though my finger is not long enough, and the tip of the rib is the crooked part. If you try to straighten it, and if you want another man at home, because that's what we want. Men, they want another man in the form of a woman. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah, and you want your wife to be like your buddy. To, as they say, دفع الطائر. She understands, you know, just, you know, she understands by signal by or by body language. She's not like your buddy. Your buddy, you may go like this to him, خلاص. No need to say anything. Your wife, you may go the same thing. What? What does this guy want? And she go, you know, and she boils some eggs. And like, what does boiling eggs have to do with this? Well, she understood that you want eggs boiled. She's not like your buddy. So men, husbands want his wife to be like his friend, but of course he doesn't want a man at home. He wants her in a woman's body. You don't get both, Habib. If you want a woman, then you have to take her as she is. There will be some crookedness, and you just leave it as it is, and you enjoy it in this fashion, and vice versa. And life goes on. You try to straighten it, it will break. So you need to take care of them. This is because of their sensitivity, because of their emotionalism. This is what is intended. Among the meanings intended, I don't want to limit it to that. Among the meanings, and any woman will testify to that. Women are more emotional, they are more sensitive than men can ever be. So this requires care and gentle. A man doesn't care. So don't take this as an offense. This is not here, the hadith is not offending you. The hadith is speaking about ghaib. This is from the unseen, which Allah revealed. These are facts. And we experience them at home. So you know what I'm saying. Complaining to and consulting them. Consult your wife. Complain to her the problems you are facing at work. She loves it. Now we don't like to hear what happened at home when we come home. Right? When you come home, all you want to see is a plate of food. Right? She's going to tell you all of it, blah, 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 the school called and they said that, you know, your son needs a pack of pencils. They're like, oh no, not again. Yeah, Shaykh, I'll write a list of things, Allah and Allah. Just write a list of things that I need. Don't be talking to me about what I need. I'm not going to remember. We don't like to hear it. But you come home, unless the woman is weird, you come home and you say, you know what happened at work? What happened? What happened at work? And she may, you know, turn off the AC and turn off the light and sit down and have a cup of juice and just, she just wants to hear. It may be the most boring story in the world, but she likes it. And it may be lame, but she will laugh. You may be very, you know, lame, you're not even funny. She will think it's a great joke, right? So women are different than men. They like it when you complain to them, the problems that you're facing, and when you seek advice from them. Now you all know in the Sulh of Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, when the Sahaba Prophet went to the Mecca to do the Umrah, they were prevented by the Quraishis. They did the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, and basically they had brought the Hadi, the sacrificial animal, with them. Now they can no longer complete the Umrah, so they have to sacrifice the Hadi, shave their heads, and go back to Medina. The Prophet, now the Sahaba were very upset. They were prevented by the kuffar. He said to the Sahaba, sacrifice your animal, shave your heads. No one did a thing. This is very unusual for the Sahaba. But they're human beings. And they were emotionally, you know, outraged at the event. They didn't. He didn't obey the Prophet. He told them, I'm telling you, slaughter your animals and shave your heads. And they didn't carry out. He went inside. Umm Salama was with him on the travel.
And he told the Musalamah, he said, I'm telling them they're not listening to me. He said, go back out, don't say a word. Slaughter your animal and call your barber to shave your head. And he did. This is the Messenger of Allah who receives revelation, got his advice from his wife. He went out, he did that. The Sahaba almost killed each other out of grief when they seen him do that. Then everyone did exactly what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. So this here, the advice came from Umm Salama. And in the same light, we husbands, those who are married, you need sometimes your wife's advice. Because we may get, you know, stubborn, or we may think too in a business-oriented fashion, whereas she thinks in a more gentle fashion concerning the rights of others. You need your wife's advice. Seek advice from her, complain to her, consult her. Even if you don't take her opinion at the end, she feels happy that she was involved in something. This is something that men must do for the house to be a place of rest. Otherwise, every time you make a decision and you don't consult her and she warns you, what happens afterwards? I told you, you didn't listen to me. You will never hear the end. Every day I told you, which reminds me of a joke. There was a woman who used to nag every day, nag, you know, nagging, complaining. So the husband gets fed up with this. He said, listen, lady, we're going to have to do this another way. One day you nag, and the next day you give me a break. She said, fair enough. So the first day came, she's nagging about all kinds of things. I need this, I want that, I don't like this, whatever. So then the day was over, the husband, alhamdulillah, tomorrow, inshallah, is a new day. I don't have to hear any nagging. So the next day around came, and she started saying, tomorrow I'm going to nag, tomorrow I'm going to nag, tomorrow I'm going to nag. Ba'den, tomorrow I'm going to nag. Khalas, this is the nagging that we don't want. You're nagging already. You know what I'm saying? So be careful, huh? You will never hear the end of it. Consult her even if you don't listen. Eat and drink with them. I have one, barakallah fiqh, but shukran. I may sell 50 halalas. Eating and drinking with them. The Prophet ﷺ was very gentle. I don't know which one of us did this last time. He would, whenever Aisha would drink from a cup or a pot or something while she was menstruating, he would deliberately look for the place where she placed her lips and she would drink from the same place. And if she ate from some, you know, a bone that had some meat on it, then he would also fetch for the place where she placed her mouth and he will eat from the same place. This can make wonders at home. If only we can do it. If only we can do it. No elaboration. Helping them in the household duties. Listen to this now. Aisha radiallahu anha said, she went asked about the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his home. She replied, he was helping in doing the family duties, and when he hears the call of prayer, he goes out. Yani he would be involved at home doing the duties of the household. He's not sitting there on a special couch, and everyone else works at home, and he only receives services, right? Because you know what happens, we have a complex. You go to work, right? If you work in an office or otherwise, and you have a manager, and the manager is telling you, do this, don't do that. You have a deadline for this. You need to finish this by this date, blah, blah, blah. So you have this, you know, this complex. Someone always telling you what to do. So when we go home, now we want to play the role of the boss. Yeah, I'm going to do what the boss does to me. So we try to do the same thing because of a complex which we have. But that's not fair for the wife. Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ, he used to wash his own clothes. When was the last time you did laundry? He used to milk his own, you know, that he would bring his own milk. When was the last time you poured yourself a cup of juice? And he used to serve himself. When was the last time you went to the pot and you put some food in the plate and sat back down and ate it? Allahu A'lam. Maybe some of us have a 5-star service at home. Everything is done by wifey, but the Prophet ﷺ used to get involved. Furthermore, she said, he used to sew his own clothes. He would patch something that went, you know, that had a hole in it. He would clean his own shoes, and he would do what men generally do at home back then. They used to do a lot of things. Now we don't do much. He used to fix his own clothes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would wash his own clothes. What else do we want? This means that you help the wife
in the home, the duties of home, the tasks, the chores, you get involved. You don't burden her with too many tasks which she cannot carry out. Share happiness with them. You all know the hadith where Prophet ﷺ raced with Aisha. That he was going on an expedition, they were traveling, and it was her turn. He told the Sahaba, move ahead. They all moved ahead. Then he remained behind with her, and then they raced when she was young. So she beat him. So then a few years later, after she gained some weight, she wasn't as young anymore. Then they raced again, and then he beat her. So he said, hadhihi bitil, this one is for that one. And he still remembered the first time. So be nice to them, playing with them. It's okay for you to be a comedian at home, believe it or not. If you ever want to crack jokes and be rewarded for it, then be the best funny guy at home with your wife and the children. It's a sunnah to make him happy. Because there's a hadith which I don't remember the wording, but among the things which Allah allows, which are pleasing to Allah, is the hadith of a man with his wife that, you know, bringing happiness to them even if it's just joking. This is besides the other kind of jokes which are not acceptable. Mashi? So be funny. Be funny at home. Keep a smile on everyone's face. And everyone will be happy. Hold on a second. I will have to skip a couple of them here. Just so that we will not run out of time. Consoling them and wiping their tears. Safiya was traveling with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And it was then her turn to travel with him. She was slow in walking. The Prophet ﷺ received her while crying and saying, you gave me a slow camel. Seeing that, the Prophet ﷺ wiped her eyes with his hands and consoled her. He wiped her tears with his hands, alayhi salatu wasalam. Yani being nice, affectionate, being kind. We very often fail to do that. In fact, the most common disease amongst men is when his wife cries, he gets more upset. Stop crying! I said, stop crying! No, stop crying! I told you, stop crying! How is she going to stop crying now, ya faylasuf zamanak? If you're beating her, how is that going to stop? You know, we are strange people, man. I mean, I don't know how we twist things. The wife is already suffering and we impose more stress on her, and then we want things to happen the other way around. It doesn't happen this way. Now we need to develop this kind of sensitivity, which I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant each and every one of us here. Consider her best manners. No one is perfect, not the men nor the women. If you're not perfect, why do you expect a perfect wife? And it was said that a person told, you know, his wife, look at Aisha, look at Khadija, look at, you know, Safiya, look at ila akhirihi. He named it, he said, she said, yeah. And he said, you need to act like them. She said, you act like the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam first, and then I will act like them. Where are you from the Messenger of Allah? You want me to be like Ummul Mu'mineen, and you are like someone else. You're not like the Messenger of Allah. You do your job, she will do her job. So, you know, we need to, you know, realize that they have shortcomings. Prophet ﷺ said, the faithful husband should not hate his faithful wife, because if he hates a certain manner in her character, then he should not forget the other good manners in her character. She may have some bad things about her. You remember other good things, so you let alone, you let go, you ignore, you turn a blind eye concerning the things which you don't like. Because she's not perfect, but neither are you. So, you know, if we dislike something, keep it as that. Trust them. Some men, you know, they watched maybe Alfred Hitchcock back in the day, or some of these, you know, suspense movies, and he thinks he's a detective. So he always wants to catch his wife, you know, doing something wrong, even though she's not doing anything wrong. That's haram. And the Prophet ﷺ said, forbade that a man should come unexpectedly to his wife like a night visitor, doubting her fidelity and spying into her lapses. In another narration, he did not mention trying to charge them with treason or follow their mistakes. Yani, don't try to, you know, find them betraying you, deliberately come and say, honey, I'm going to come, you know, my flight is tomorrow 1 o'clock in the morning, or whatever, and he knows it's coming at a different time. But he wants to come early to catch her doing something wrong. The men are not supposed to do this to the women, and obviously the women are not supposed to do this to the men. Can't be looking through his emails, can't be looking through his phone and his text messages, assuming he's doing ABC. No. You build the household on trust. Unless you have clear evidence wherein there's no doubt that there's something fishy, in which case then you do your investigation. Beforehand, don't assume evil. Wives have to trust their husbands and vice versa. Otherwise, you will live a miserable life. But if you trust your wife, alhamdulillah. Give her a nickname. Give her a good nickname. Prophet ﷺ, Aisha complained that she doesn't have a nickname. He called her Umm Abdullah. The mother of Abdullah, she never gave birth to any children. She didn't have Abdullah. But it was a nickname because she wanted a nickname. Today we give a nickname, but not the nice one. Now some people call their, you know, their wives all kinds of, you know, silly names. Every time he calls her, he's actually insulting her. That's against the sunnah. Find a name that she likes, you know. If she likes to be called Peach, call her Peach. If she's a strawberry, call her strawberry. Even if she doesn't look like a strawberry, we mushkila. Strawberries come in different sizes and shapes and forms. You know, mashi hala. Just be diplomatic, as they say. Let things go. Give her a nice name. She likes it. Don't be calling her something silly. Love and respect their families. Love and respect their families. Don't you know, and this requires a lecture on its own. The conflict between the in-laws. Well, my parents don't like him and they don't like her, so everybody gets involved. But each one has to show respect to the other's parents. Help them out. Don't make things difficult. Excuse me for that. This has nothing to do with water. If I drink cold water, I will cough even more. Tight. Refraining from beating or abusing them. The Prophet ﷺ, the best example to be followed, has never ever beaten any woman. He had 9. Any servant or anything in his hand other than fighting in the way of Allah, the Almighty. He does not take revenge from anyone harmed him, anyone who harmed him, except when breaching the orders of Allah, the Almighty. At which case, he takes revenge. Not for his own personal revenge. If someone violated the deen of Allah, he will take revenge for the deen of Allah, not for himself. He never struck a wife of his. Never in his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Furthermore, he said, none of you should beat his wife as he beats his slave and then have sexual intercourse with her at the later part of the night. Yeah, and some men are strange. They abuse their wives in the day and then they expect everything else at night. This is very difficult for a woman. Very difficult. This is psychologically very difficult. So this whole idea of beating women is something that is not entertained. As the ulama explained, the ayah which comes in the Quran, I left the siwak in the car, it's with the siwak. Tick. You don't put the siwak through her head. Because someone said, okay, siwak, now how much damage can I do with the siwak? I'm sure. So they put, you know, a knife at the top of the siwak, and then they make it an arrow. Say, well, brother, this was a siwak, as you said in the hadith in the lecture. No, I didn't. It's a gentle kind of strike. You don't punch your wife, you don't choke her, and you don't sit on her, and any of the things which we hear, and we get in the emails. None of that stuff, man. It's not befitting. If you're really a tough guy, you know, do this among the disbelievers on the battlefield. I'm not going to say among your Muslim brothers. You know, which reminds me, I mentioned this joke before, and I can do it again, that a man fought with his wife, and she was at her mother's house, her parents' house. So while fighting over there, he told her, if you're a man, meet me outside. if you're really a man, meet me outside. Not because in your parents' house you're, you know, being all tough, go outside. What are you going to do to her outside? Beat up your own wife, yes, yeah? Mayfa. طيب. Advice to women, because women are happy now. Yeah, tell him. Yeah, put him straight. Well, you got something too. Allah told us, He summarized the real good woman. The real good woman in Islam is defined in the Quran. فَالصَّالِحَاتُ قَانِتَاتٌ حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ بِمَا حَفِظَ اللَّهُ. This is the summary. So good women are obedient to Allah, His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and her husband,
By the way, many people don't know this. If this was here, and this is mubah, let me make it a bottle. This is allowed. If a husband says to his wife, give me this bottle, it's an obligation on her Islamically to give him the bottle. You understand what I'm saying? Because obeying the husband is a fard. Unless he tells her to disobey Allah. This is halal. If he says to his wife, give me this bottle, she must give him this bottle. She doesn't have a choice. Otherwise, she becomes disobedient. Now, of course, husband shouldn't play with his wife in this fashion by telling her to do different things. But we're saying that the asl, she has to obey her husband. So Allah said, they are obedient, guarding in secret that which Allah has guarded. They guard in secret that which Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded to be guarded. So when the husband is gone, she protects his wealth, she protects herself, she protects his family, his children, and what have you. This is the definition of a good woman. She's obedient and all. And most of the problems is because of the woman's disobedience. She doesn't want to obey her husband. Yes, in things that are haram, I'm the first to tell you, ignore him. But in things which are not haram, sister, you have to do it. Otherwise, you're not playing your role in fulfilling the household and making it a place of rest. Listen to this hadith. A woman came to consult the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to her, you there, are you married? She said, yes. He said, how are you toward your husband? She said, I do not fall short in anything except that which I am unable to do. Anything within my capability, I carry out. The only thing I don't do is something which is beyond my ability. If he says do 100 push-ups, I cannot do 100 push-ups. Beyond my ability. He said, well, look after your position in relation to him. For it is the key to paradise and hell. Your position concerning him is the key to paradise or hell. Yeah, and if you continue to do this, you will go to Jannah. If you go off track, you may go to hell. This is supported with another narration. The Prophet ﷺ said, if a woman prayed her 5 prayers, fasted her month of Ramadan, protected herself from anything haram, and obeyed her husband, she will enter paradise. That's it. You do your salah, siyam, protect yourself, and Jannah is guaranteed for you. The men have to do a lot more things to guarantee this Jannah. Allah made it easier for the woman in this sense. Alhamdulillah. Don't ask for divorce because you don't have the right to ask for divorce unless there's an Islamic legitimate reason. There are grounds for you to ask for divorce. And there are times where you don't have the right to ask for divorce. The problem is now every time a woman is unhappy, she asks for divorce. And she challenges the man, divorce me if you're a man. Prophet ﷺ said, if any woman asks her husband to divorce her without a reason, Allah will prohibit her the smell of paradise. She will not even smell the fragrance of Jannah. If the man has a major problem, which is Islamically related, then you may seek divorce or you may seek khul'a, and I'm not going to go into all the details. Otherwise, every time you're not happy with him, you ask for divorce, no, it's haram. The Prophet ﷺ further advised women that some of them have the tendency to be ungrateful. He said, I see that you were most of the inhabitants of the hellfire. Why? Because you are ungrateful. A man will do a lot of things, and one day he does something wrong, she says, you've never done anything good. So the sister has to be also fair and just. If the man makes some effort and sometimes he has shortcomings, be patient with him. Be patient with him. This is the role which you have to play. You be obedient. You do what Allah Azza wa Jalla said, everything will be fine. In summary, Allah says, وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. And do not forget graciousness between yourselves. No matter what happens, remember that Allah Azza wa Jalla made you halal for each other. You would have been haram for each other except through this marriage. This marriage wedlock is what made this relation between this strange man and this strange woman lawful. Remember the graciousness between you. And don't go off track when you disagree. Don't become like the munafiq. وَإِذَا فَاجَرَ وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرَ. When he disagrees, he goes to extremes. He blows things out of proportion. Keep things within limitations. And remember that the most noble, or let's say the most unnoble objective for Iblis is divorce. And we dealt with the narration before, that he places his throne on water, he sends his soldiers, And one will come and say, I made this person disobey Allah and this. He'll say, you didn't do anything. The other will say, oh, I made him disobey Allah and that thing. He'll say, no, you didn't do anything. Until one comes to him, he says, I remained whispering to him and inciting him until he divorced her, his wife. And he continued to whisper to the man to divorce the wife. Until he did, he will embrace him. And he will say, anta, you. Shaitan, Iblis, is most satisfied when he causes the household to break apart. So don't open this door for the shaitan. Unless the husband is not feeling Allah and there's no room for rectification, or vice versa. Otherwise, try to keep the household sound. So, quick notes. Build a library. Build an Islamic library at home. Dedicate time for seeking knowledge and live Islam at home. If you want Islam to spread all over the world, if you want Islam to be superior to other religions, then we need to live Islam at home. If you want everyone to govern by the rulings of Islam, then we need to govern by the rulings of Islam at home. Which means that a lot of the haram which we have must be taken out. These pictures, put them down. This TV, turn it off. This music, shut it down. Anything which is going to bring the shayateen and take out the angels, you don't need it. Otherwise, you will not have the house as a place of rest. Shayateen in the house, no rest. We need to make this bold, courageous move. We need to leave alone these things which destroy households. You say it's tough? I say, akhi, our home is Jannah. The suffering in the dunya is for you to go to Jannah. If you don't want to suffer, you won't go to Jannah. Suffering is part of it. حُفَّةِ الْجَنَّةِ بِالْمَكَارِهِ The things that you dislike, you have to do in order to make it to Jannah. Sacrifice, it's the responsibility of the man. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ The brother, the husband, you are in charge for ensuring that the household is living by the Islamic principles. And the sister is responsible for the same thing. If we don't carry them out, then we will deal with all of the consequences of the day of reckoning. For ourselves and our children. So brothers and sisters in Islam, we don't need any more domestic confrontations. We need domestic facilitations. Domestic love and compassion. We need nice, sound Islamic households which will bring the generation to come, which will bring for the next generation that will be able to live Islam on an international level. So that the affair of the Muslims will change. And ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to facilitate that for all of us. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.